Parklands College is a progressive place of teaching and learning and offers a challenging yet warm and stimulating environment for our learners from pre-primary to grade 12. Exemplary teaching, project-based learning and creative instructional activities are at the centre of the Parklands College curriculum. We strive for excellence, leadership and innovation in education, and as a result have been recognised as an Apple Distinguished School. Throughout the college, our approach to learning is innovative, enriched and flexible, where technology is fully integrated into our learning programme. We recognise the innate potential and diverse learning styles of each child. We focus on providing excellence in education, sport and cultural activities, culminating in well-balanced, empowered, confident and independent future leaders. Our little ones come through our doors of Christopher Robin Pre-Primary each day and are given opportunities to discover, communicate, share and create. They are our future engineers, physicists, sculptors, doctors and storytellers. Our little ones' happiness is at the heart of what we do, and equally important is the exciting, active learning and teaching that occurs to keep little minds engaged. We aim to bring learning to life, indoors and outdoors, as the children are taken on a journey of exploration and discovery. Our days are filled with music, movement, storytelling, building and creating. Confidence and independence is nurtured as these little discoverers, policemen and ballerinas interact and become key role players in their world of make-believe. The use of information technology is play-centered and interactive, promoting healthy, age-appropriate development and discovery. We strive to create a happy, loving and irresistible environment in which our children are able to thrive and grow, and our free-thinking, confident and independent little people are assured of success on joining Grade 1. Our world-class educational offering has at its core the Parklands Mind, which is the practice of developing critical thinkers, creative agents, effective communicators, purposeful collaborators, and responsible citizens. Every learner has an innate wish to explore their world, and the Preparatory provides a platform for such experiential learning. Learners' ideas and expressions are valued, and the ultimate goal of producing confident, independent learners is achieved within a technology-rich, creative, and intellectually stimulating environment. The early years of children's formal education is the foundation upon which future academic and life skills are built. A natural curiosity blossoms within our classrooms, which are supportive, dynamic, and inquiry-based. The smooth transition from preparatory to secondary is ensured as a result of the liaison and close collaboration between the two faculties. The secondary faculty offers academic experiences that provide each learner with a firm grasp of fundamental skills. The ability to think critically, innovatively, and independently while exposing our young learners to computational thinking, electronics, the sciences, commerce, the arts, and technology develops the building blocks for learning. Career-focused interests are provided for and include sound engineering, filming and editing, movie making, music, and hospitality. Culture is incorporated throughout the curriculum. Performing and visual arts provide a vital opportunity for free expression and exposes our learners to a variety of art forms. Dance, drama and music are universal languages that cross all cultural barriers and complement our mission to develop well-rounded learners. Participation in campus life contributes to the holistic development of each learner and provides them with the opportunity to become involved and achieve in various sporting activities. Sport is an integral part of college life and is introduced at pre-primary level. We see sporting activities as an opportunity for learners to develop both physical and life skills, promoting healthy competition, self-discipline, and camaraderie. It also provides for social interaction with other schools on national and international level. We recognize the value of information and communication technology by providing comprehensive programs from pre-primary to grade 12, enabling our learners to obtain internationally accredited certifications. Learners enter the Apple One-to-One Device program from grade 1, where technology infuses every area of the curriculum, and each child's device becomes a personalized learning platform. We offer robotics and coding from grade R, information technology as a matric subject, international CompTIA and Adobe certifications, in addition to participation in STEAM-focused Olympiads and competitions. Parklands College continues to explore new and emerging technologies in order to keep abreast of world trends in education. Our learners create and release apps on the Apple App Store in our mobile application development incubator, create their own original music and release it on the Apple iTunes Store in our sound engineering studios, create films, music videos, and newsreels for YouTube. The Innovation Center on the Sandown campus was designed with the future of learning in mind. The large collaboration spaces, visually connected to smaller learning pods, are ideal for meeting in smaller groups and filming using green screen technology. Our robotics lab and Experium provide our learners with opportunities to prototype solutions to real-world problems. This space is also home to digital electronics, 3D printing, and laser cutting. Grand Central hosts the Bridge, as well as the virtual reality holodeck. The holodeck provides immersive learning experiences using virtual reality simulations, where learners are able to dissect the human body or explore the International Space Station. Parklands College offers an environment which fosters curiosity and an eagerness to learn, preparing each learner to take on life's challenges as the global entrepreneurs of tomorrow. From bright-eyed toddlers to bright-eyed teens, our learning program is designed to develop learners who are compassionate, confident, and independent, literate, numerate, and multi-skilled, with a respect for the environment and the ability to participate in society as a critical and active citizen. To this end, the college is supported by a dynamic, innovative, and nurturing team of teachers and managers who constantly aspire to instill this philosophy of lifelong learning. Reaching outwards, growing minds, building futures. Welcome to the Parklands College family.
A very warm welcome and thank you for joining us today. Thank you for joining us for this rescheduled event of preparing learners for their futures. As you may know, there was a global outage with Microsoft Teams 20 minutes into our presentation during the session on Wednesday. So we are very grateful to be able to share the rest of our story with you today. So for those of you who did join us on Wednesday, the first 20 minutes of this presentation will be the same as you would have seen on Wednesday. And thereafter, we have lots more in store for you. Please make use of our social media handles, as you can see on the screen, as well as World Edu Week and Parklands College hashtags, so you can share your thoughts around what you are seeing today. On the right-hand side of your screen, you will see and find a Q&A section, and we're going to be monitoring this for questions and going to have a time for Q&A right at the end of the hour that we have together. So I'd like to start off by introducing our speakers to you today. My name is Paul. I'm the Associate Principal of Innovation at the Secondary Faculty at Parklands College. Emma is the Head of Innovative Learning at the Preparatory Faculty, and Richard on the right-hand side, one of our college founders and the Director for Technology Innovation. And we are delighted to have some learners join us today as well from the prep school and pre-recorded this to what we saw on Wednesday night. We have Melina and Amelia, and they are two of our grade six learners, and then Lizwe is one of our grade four learners. Then from the secondary faculty speakers this evening, learners, we've got Christine, Sadira, and Keegan, and they are going to be joining us from the secondary faculty. But right now we're going to hand over to our first speaker for the day, and that is Richard Nags. He is one of our college founders as well as the Director of Technology Innovation and has been responsible for launching and implementing its infrastructure and technology programs. Welcome and over to you, Richard.
Hi, everyone. It really is a pleasure to be able to share our story with you today. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to start with a little bit of Parklands College history. And we were founded in Cape Town, South Africa in 1998. And we offer a caring and holistic environment for learners from 18 months to 18 years old. And our school vision is to best prepare our learners for their futures through the development of global competencies, or what are better known as 21st century skills. And we do this by giving our learners opportunities to find their purpose by solving and attempting to address real world challenges. So our vision is also supported by innovation in education and the integration of technology into learning and teaching. So our technology vision was put in place when the college was first conceptualized, and it has always been supported by top management. And because of this, the result has been that our journey has been really long and really, really rewarding. So we officially launched our Apple MacBook program in the classroom in July 2010. And from this moment onwards, we never looked back because we found this intuitive and reliable platform with very, very well integrated applications. And when we achieved Apple one-to-one or complete one-to-one status in 2015, where every single learner had a device for learning in the college, we began to experience the most incredible transformation and innovation in the college. And this allowed us to focus on something that we call our growing minds approach. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that in the next slide. In 2016, we were proudly recognized by Apple as an Apple Distinguished School for innovation, leadership, and excellence in education. And in August 2018, we were recognized once again for continued progress in these areas. So as our learners and teachers began to use technology confidently in learning and teaching, we focused our attention to a broader purpose, and that's the growing minds approach. And here we defined exactly the five global competencies that we believe really essential for our learners to adapt to the changing workplace and the future world. And what we essentially want to do is to create learners who can effectively communicate their ideas with each other, work purposefully in teams, being able to leverage each other's strengths, to be able to come up with really creative ways to solve real-world problems and challenges that they've identified through their critical thinking. And what's really important is that they need to, while they're doing this, understand the place they have in this world and what they can do to make it a better place. So that's the responsible citizenship part of it. So what we've done as management is we've embedded this growing minds approach into our professional learning program so that our teachers can include it in their teaching practice. So every year we offer approximately 70 hours of professional learning to our teachers. And this training is not only about how to use technology, but it's about how to use technology effectively in learning and teaching, as well as pedagogical practice. And the training we offer is bespoke, depending and according to the faculty, and it covers different areas from how to use an app or a tool in the classroom, all the way through to cross-curricular project-based learning. And then our teachers take these approaches and they integrate them into their planning for the classroom. So we've also made time in our timetable, in our school day, for what we call CNI sessions, and that's an acronym for Create and Innovate. And here our teachers meet and plan how to integrate subjects into this cross-curricular project-based learning approach. We've also recently started a new internal initiative called Sharing Stories. And this is a space where our teachers can share their learning experiences with other teachers from in other faculties. And what it's done is it's given our teachers a platform to shine and to share their experiences and successes. But overall, what is important is that in our school, we've developed a culture of professional learning where we promote experimentation, the courage to always try something new, and you know, to be willing to share their skills and experiences with each other. So Paul, back to you.
Thank you so much, Richard, and thank you for outlining us just how key vision is. And I think if you're putting a project of this nature together, having a vision and having it supported right from the top is key to actually making it actually a reality in your school. Together coupled with authentic learning experiences make the learning meaningful. And trying wherever possible to actually reach into your community with what you're doing. And I think one of the keys for us at Parklands College is a dynamic professional learning program, where every week there is space for professional learning within the timetable. So in the next few minutes, we're going to be crossing to a section of a recording that we had during our interrupted event on Wednesday. And Emma's going to introduce the preparatory learners, and then will join us live to continue our story as we learn from the preparatory faculty speakers. Right at the end of the presentation, Emma will be live with us for a Q&A. So if you do have any questions, don't forget to pop them into the Q&A so we can discuss them at the end of the hour. Over to our preparatory faculty.
Hi everyone, I'm so proud to be here today And I'm even prouder to be here with some of our learners. We have two awesome girls with us today who saw a problem and decided to be change makers and make a difference. What makes this story so special and in a really standout story is that they decided to do this all on their own initiative. Now, I'm going to hand you over to Amelia and Melina, who are going to tell you a little bit more themselves.
Our journey began with Melina, Isabella, and I working together and writing down ideas on how we can save the wildlife. We wanted to make a difference after seeing some videos online. We thought of a few ideas, but the best one was to host a bake sale to raise some funds for the World Wildlife Fund. We started by making a meeting with our principal to show her a presentation we made on our iPads of what we wanted to do and why we wanted to do it. We spent a lot of our break times working together on how we can make the bake sale a success. After an assembly, we asked our grade to stay behind and ask for their support in bringing baked goods for us to sell to the school. They were all very excited to support us. It was awesome.
We designed our posters on our iPads and advertised the idea of the bake sale to the school. The day of the bake sale was exciting. We were so appreciative to see how well we were supported. We set up the tables and everyone came to buy all the treats. So many people came to buy the treats that we were left with nothing on the tables. We were able to raise a large amount of money for the WWF and presented them with our donation in an assembly. We feel our small effort brought awareness to our school and we're very proud of what we did.
Thanks, girls. Well, what I hope you were able to see there is that Amelia and Melina were given a space to be independent and use real-world skills to make a difference. They arranged meetings, created presentations, and organized a school event. And our teachers made sure that they gave them a space to be the change makers they wanted to be. And this is the one way that we are developing our growing minds approach. Now, I have another learner with me here today, Leslie. Now, he's in grade 4, and he's going to tell you about a cross-curricular, project-based learning project we did that involved painting, art, robotics, 3D printing, and even coding. Leslie, off to you.
My partner and I worked on a fun project that took 3 to 4 weeks called the Cuckoo Bird Project. I was very nervous because I knew nothing about building a cuckoo bird house. I wasn't very good at painting, but then I took my time and started breathing. Then it became easy and I enjoyed it. I thought the coding would be difficult, but then it turned out I just had to use what I learned from robotics class for the project. When I became frustrated, I realized I just needed help because I couldn't do it all by myself. My partner and I did lots of discussions and different options. When we designed the 3D bird on our iPads, it was so exciting to get my bird printed. It was a little tricky getting to look the way I wanted it, but I did my best. I loved doing this fun project.
Well, what you just heard there from Leslie is that this is a superb example of project-based learning. Our principal has a strong vision and a determination to make learning meaningful, and we do this best through PBLs. We learned really early on that the best form of PBL is one that is cross-curricular. It allows our learning to be more authentic, gives our learners the space to make mistakes in a safe place, and it's a lot of fun, and we have the beautiful collaboration and communication with our learners. We've dedicated a great deal of time to developing our teachers' knowledge on PBL, and you can see that each project gets better as the confidence grows. You start off by looking at where are those links, where's that cross-curricular happening in the curriculum, and you start plotting and planning. Now, it does take a lot of time, but it is so worth it because the learning is so valuable. And we've also been able to wiggle in some of our assessments, which has been great. Now, that's only a little bit of our story from the prep. And if you'd like to know more, follow us on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter. But I'm going to hand you back to Paul, and he's going to fill you in on a little bit more.
Thank you so much to Emma and our prep school team. I get so excited when I hear about what they're doing. And it's because it's real and it's authentic. Project-based learning has really been a great catalyst for us to move our learning forward, breaking down some of the silos between subjects and being able to make our learning meaningful. Igniting passions and giving learners opportunities to succeed really make them enjoy their learning more. So a great reminder there of what learning can look like. So thank you to Emma and your team. Reminder today, we also have a Q&A right at the end of this hour. So if you do have some questions, we're going to be taking questions as a team. So please pop them into the Q&A on the right-hand side of the event. We now hand over to Richard. He's going to share some more about what Parklands has in terms of other opportunities that we offer our learners.
Great. Thank you, Paul. So what we've done at our school is we've made time in the school day for many different passion-led experiential learning courses and subjects. And we call these further extension opportunities, and you can see a whole list of them in that slide. And the reason why we do this is because it allows our learners to explore areas that they never would normally be able to in a standard curriculum and acquire skills that they can use in any subject or in any project that they may be busy with. So our goal here is to help our learners find their passions and their interests early and to find relevance in their learning by applying it to the real world. So our managing director, Lorraine Roth, she has such an incredible vision for education, because in 2006, she identified that the integration of Lego systems into the classroom and into our offering as a whole would add a completely new dimension to learning. So what happened was two gentlemen from Hands-On Technologies came to the school and introduced or delivered some introduction training to Lego systems. And this was about what we had to do is we had to construct a mini conveyor belt, and that mini conveyor belt had to move objects around the room. And this engineering hands-on experience just was so much fun, so engaging and incredibly collaborative. And what we found was, or what we began to realize, was that this would have incredible potential in the hands of our learners. And little did we know the impact that LEGO education systems would have on sparking a STEAM, play-based, experiential learning approach in the college. Because not only has LEGO ignited and sparked creativity and inventiveness in our learners, it's also shaped the development of our latest robotics lab and our latest making and inventing labs. And you can see a picture of our latest robotics lab in the slide. So at this point in time, we have a fully integrated play-based LEGO education learning system in our school. And learners from 18 months to grade R can use LEGO soft bricks, Duplo, six bricks, and early simple machines. And we use soft bricks to ensure whole body movement and development while our learners are playing make-believe, building castles and boats and bridges, and learning to actually play with their friends. And we also use them in numeracy and literacy as well. Duplo Lego, and that is actually double the size of normal Lego, provides an opportunity for our pre-primary to grade one learners to develop their motor skills, sensory perception, number concepts, language, and perceptual skills. And that's through various structured and unstructured building activities. And as you can see in the slide, our learners also really enjoy making animated movies with the different Lego parts. So, an exciting thing that we've also introduced into the classroom is from grade R to grade four, every single learner receives their very own set of six colorful Duplo Lego bricks called six bricks. And these tools are just so much fun and so amazing. What happens is, for example, if the learners have just come in from the playground and you want to settle them, you can hold these six bricks up in front of you and go 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and put it behind your back and say, okay, so remember the order of the colors. So it helps with memory skills. It helps with imagination. You can get them to build different objects and 3D perception as well. They can sit back to back and then go through a process of trying to explain to the person behind them what the structure is that they have in their hands. So it really helps with 3D perception. And there's just so many other fun activities that could be used in the classroom. So early simple machines, that introduces our grade R to one learners to simple engineering concepts such as gears and pulleys and levers. And how they do this is they build and they explore simple machines using this Duplo size Lego, which is double the size of normal Lego. Now, in one of our projects, and you can see in the picture on the right, our learners had to make their own theme park rides and Ferris wheels. And what they had to do was they had to calculate how much money they would make depending on the number of seats on the Ferris wheel, and then how many rides they could have on their Ferris wheel depending on the number of visitors to the park. So it really allowed them to explore mathematical and problem-solving concepts in a really fun way. When we achieved Apple one-to-one status in our preparatory faculty in April 2013, every single learner in our preparatory faculty had an iPad. And as a result, our IT labs became massively underutilized because technology skills were naturally learned in the classroom. So we had to have a look at these IT labs and decide, well, what are we actually going to do with these spaces? So we had a look at our vision again, and knowing that the future would be infused with technology, with automation, with coding, and the Internet of Things, we decided to specialize these spaces. And we turned our IT labs into specialist robotics venues where our learners could develop problem-solving skills, computational thinking, while playing and discovering these tools. In April 2014, we officially integrated LEGO Robotics into learning from grade one. And this has given every learner in our school exposure to robotics, automation, coding, and mechanics. And that it's just amazing to see how curious and how interested they are now in science, technology, engineering, the arts, and mathematics, all the STEAM-based subjects and areas. So our learners are now using their imagination to create the most incredible machines that are automated with code. And in the image on the left, a team of learners, they designed a moon base and it addressed various topics such as energy and water production and waste removal on the moon. And then they looked at challenges such as low gravity, you know, just to mention a few of the issues they were looking at. And they had to present the ideas to a panel of judges in the junior first LEGO League competition. And you know, what is incredible is just how amazing our young learners' ideas are. And it's just a great opportunity for them to be able to share those with everyone, as well as explore the 21st century and the global competencies that we're trying to develop in the growing minds. So what we do is we extend our LEGO Robotics offering by taking part in international challenge-based robotics competitions, as I mentioned earlier, Junior First LEGO League. And these competitions challenge our learners to solve real-world problems based on a theme. Now, two competitions that are particularly relevant are the First LEGO League and the World Robot Olympiad Open category. And the reason they're so important is because their themes address a different United Nations Sustainable Development Goal every year. And teams of learners are required to solve or come up with a solution for the SDG for that year and then present their solution to a panel of judges. And hopefully if their solution is good enough, they can be selected to represent the country on an international level. But one example that I always love to share is an invention by one of the teams that we had, the Hyperion Bots, and they were a first LEGO League team. And in this particular year, the competition's real world theme was hydrodynamics. And here participants had to learn all about water, how we find it, how we transport it, use it, and dispose of it. Now, Team Hyperion Bots, they developed a clean water provision process for rural communities. And it begins with them having to pump water from a lake or a dam, putting it into a HIPAA barrel for transport to be purified and stored in and dispensed from what I believe to be an amazingly innovative water brick. Now, the innovation in this water brick lies in the addition of four push-pull valves. There are two on the top and two on the bottom of the brick, and they spring-loaded. So when the bricks are clipped together, what happens is the push-pull valves that are pushing against each other allow water to flow between the bricks. And this solution was originally designed for a rural setting, but their solution, they rethought their solution when Cape Town started experiencing a severe drought. And they realized that these bricks could be installed in bathrooms or in kitchens, in columns or in walls, and they could capture water from the roof, and then you could dispense the water from these water columns or water bricks with a pump or a tap. And I mean, this is a simple, but what I believe a really brilliant invention that would be amazingly useful in many countries that are experiencing drought and water shortages. Now, because coding is an integral part of what we do at the college, the Hyperion Bots also decided to develop an app, and it was a prototype app called Water Warriors. And it was for people who were experiencing water access challenges in their communities. Now, the idea of the app would be for the app to actually suggest water solutions to users after they complete a survey about the water challenges they are experiencing.
So as well as part of our coding initiative and as an Apple Distinguished School, we've introduced Swift Playgrounds in various grades in our school. Swift Playgrounds transitions our learners from a block-based coding system found in Lego Robotics to a text-based coding system found in Swift. And this is so important to us because Swift is the programming language we use for our mobile application development incubator. So the vision of MAD Studios, our mobile application developer studios, is to create young entrepreneurs of the future by enabling learners to solve community challenges through the development of free software applications. With Parklands being an Apple school, we use Swift as a development and a learning platform, and the App Store, Apple App Store, to reach an actual audience. But before I show you one of the 10 apps developed by our incubator, I need you to understand that not a single line of code has been written by a teacher in any of them. MAD Studios is an entirely learner-led initiative facilitated by a teacher. So let's have a look at Simple Learning Time. And this was developed when our preparatory teachers asked for a digital tool to teach younger learners how to tell the time, as well as various numeracy concepts. After a few learner-teacher meetings and some prototype testing, the learners in our school began to use the app, and the feedback from everyone was incredible. We were all very pleased when there was a day where there were 25,000 downloads by a US district. This truly inspired our incubator to keep going because they're realizing that their creations are actually making a difference in education, not only in our school, but to the rest of the world. Since then, we've had 46,000 downloads of this app alone. I would now like to hand over to Keegan Stradom. He is a passionate chairperson and lead developer of our MAD Studios. Over to you, Keegan.
Thank you, sir. Hello, everyone. My name is Keegan Stradom, and I have a passion for robotics as well as coding. So I am the present lead developer of the Mobile Application Development Incubator. And one of the roles as a lead developer is to try and maintain a legacy by finding someone to take over once I leave. Now, Stefan Salia, my predecessor, taught me many of the needed skills to continue the incubator before he matriculated. So we have a dedicated IT lab and also a time where we meet twice a week. Now, in this time, we plan new projects as well as discuss any challenges we are experiencing. New members also have a great opportunity to work through a set resource at their own pace, which this teaches them how to code. We also try to encourage the learners to try code as much as possible in their own time. This will just accelerate their learning exponentially. So within MAD, we strive to develop software solutions for teachers and the community, which address real-world problems, but also add value. Now, by developing these solutions, the students get real experiences that give them a deeper understanding of coding itself. We have even had Apple's Swift training courses during the school holidays, which have taught us about coding as well as best practices when coding. So Avoid was the first app I developed, and it was a really fun project for me to learn more about coding and also game development. Then, STEM Motion Box is a physics simulation that teaches learners about projectile motion, and it also gives them such a nice place to tinker and play and experiment when it comes to kinematics, which is the study of motion. Mini cricket is a management and a scoring application for a children's sport called mini cricket. Now, coaches can interactively and digitally manage and score matches. They can even get player and team statistics from calculations in this app. We are hoping that this will become the app of choice for South African mini cricket. Now, Chaos was my latest release game. And in Chaos, you move through an endless space filled with a lot of dangerous obstacles. It's a very difficult game, but it definitely tests your reflexes as well as your focus. This game really helped me extend my coding skills to a much higher level. Now, my most recent creation addresses the recent pandemic, and today I'm actually really excited to share it with you all today. So, at Parklands College, we were using a finger-based biometric system for learners and staff's daily attendance. But with the recent pandemic, these systems came under severe scrutiny. So in collaboration with my school management, I developed a COVID-19 sensitive attendance system. Now, this system can be broken up into two applications. AttendMe is a QR code generator that generates entrance or exit QR codes for staff and learners. This app runs on their personal mobile device, and they must just simply sign in with Google. ScanMe is a specialized QR code scanner that scans QR codes generated by staff and learners on AttendMe. Now, the staff and learners must just simply create their QR code and show it to a central iPad on campus running ScanMe, and they'll be clocked in. Now, this solution is a completely contactless method to clock in and out of school. Now, I know what you're thinking, what happens if a member doesn't have a mobile device? Well, members without a mobile device can easily be assigned a printed static QR code. Now, to ensure that the staff and learners are actually at school and it's not just their friend trying to sneakily clock them in while they're sitting at home, what I've done is I've enabled location-based services. Now, what this does is it allows me to verify that every single QR code that's generated was generated within 15 meters of another scanner. Each code also expires after 5 minutes, and therefore it's invalid for use. This means you can't use the same code over and over every single day. This same system can be applied in any organization with some minor changes. In the end, my highlight through this entire experience was definitely trying to figure out ways to bypass my own system and then come up with solutions to fix that. Software engineering has been my passion for a very long time now, and I'm blessed to have been given so many opportunities at a school level to take that further. It really just touches my heart to see that all these apps I've made actually add value and also have an impact on those around me. I'm excited, and I hope my apps in the future can also do the same. Thank you so much for listening. I would now like to hand over to our girls in tech who are going to tell you about their technology initiatives. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Keegan. Hi there, my name is Sadira, and with me is Christine, and we're representing our team Capable. In Essentia, we have Manuela, Brooke, and Isabella. We've participated in the Technovation and EM Girls EEC, which are two international entrepreneurial competitions for girls, where teams are challenged to identify and solve a challenge in the community through the use of technology. We became a team earlier this year, with majority of us having minimal experiences in such realms, and you can ask Christine, we had a lot to learn. Our ultimate goal is to touch lives and make a positive difference in our community, and as well as to unite and encourage others to pay it forward. Brainstorming and identifying the issue in our community took us the longest, but definitely was the most important part. Having realized that apps of a vaguely similar nature already exist, we decided to take one step back and look at what our greatest frustrations were. We spent close to 2 months deliberating and going back and forth between ideas, fleshing out the pros and the cons of each. A mark in the whiteboard was definitely the way to go. It was tough settling on an idea, but after connecting with various Rotarians and founders of local community service organizations, we decided to pursue Touchbase. It's all about using your previously established connections and then building relationships on new individuals. We grabbed every opportunity at hand to get feedback from as many people as possible. And ultimately, being passionate about giving back, Touchbase, a one-on-one service application unique to the South African market and adaptable to the world, linking a volunteer to an organization, was born. With the incredible guidance from our school and mentors, Ms. Cass, Ms. Magnotti, and Ms. Pillay, we learned many valuable life skills, such as how to effectively communicate, because due to the current circumstances in the world, the vast majority of our meetings and planning sessions were all done online. In these international competitions, we connected and supported other change makers, as well as learned this key skill of being adaptable. So before tapping into our second venture, which was EM Girls EEC, we used this time to refine and reflect on our project. We ensured that we made simple yet scalable choices and grabbed every opportunity at hand to tinker and play and make amendments during this period of time. With the incredible wisdom that our mentors had imparted upon us, we became more independent and used this acquired knowledge to make amendments before submitting our app into the second competition. Similarly, just like our app's mission is to serve the community, our community also helped us identify a prevalent issue and inspired us to go about developing a solution which mobilizes and fosters real change. There are so many different ways to go about making a difference. Ultimately, perseverance and really aspiring to solve and improve pre-existing issues led to us finding a solution to build a better world. We are so thankful to have been able to share our story and experience with you today. Please feel free to follow us on social media if you're interested in following what we are doing. This whole journey has been an absolutely amazing learning experience, and I speak on behalf of the team when I say, as a whole, that this experience really played a key factor in our growth and development as girls in technology.
Thank you so much to you girls for what you shared, also to Keegan. I cannot resist but read one of the things we have in the chat today, saying from Julian, and thank you, Julian, your learners are a great testimony to your tech prowess and how they apply this knowledge in solving the real world problem, real life problems. Well done. And we are just so proud of our learners. They do so well in taking what they learn at school and then applying it into the real world. And there are a lot of teachers behind that, but this is the learners' work that we are showcasing today. And we are really so proud of them. And these are just a few stories, and there are so many more. But due to time, we obviously don't have the time to share that today. And we do love to celebrate success. This is one of the ways we do it. We try and talk at as many events as we can, and highlighting what our learners are doing, giving them opportunities to take things forward. So I encourage you, if you've got anything that you want to add to them, follow them on social media as well. Keegan also mentioned around building succession. It's important that as they experience success, we are able to then build succession so they can teach others, and then others can build on the success that they have already. And isn't it amazing that this can all be done at school level? Well, that's not all. In addition to mobile application development, we've got lots of other further opportunities to develop creativity and give them real-world experiences. So Richard, tell us more.
Great, thank you, Paul. Yes, so we have this another really exciting space in our school. It's called Parklands College Studios. And here we have our film and sound engineering facilities. And the vision for this space is to provide a dedicated experiential space for our young creatives and any learner actually to create professional film, animation, and sound products. And that's for a global audience. And our studios have released three digital albums since 2014, Origin Volume 1, Origin Volume 2, and our most recent album is Mandela Day Music Celebration 2020. And in this space, we encourage our learners to create original music, and we take them through the process of the ideation and the creation of the music, and finally the mastering and the release on a store such as iTunes or Spotify. And what we really, really excited about the Mandela Day album, because it is basically available on digital music stores for purchase, as I said, and all proceeds from this album will be donated to the Mandela Day Foundation. And this foundation inspires individuals to take action for the better and to build a global movement for good. So this and these kind of initiatives really motivate our learners to create a wonderful, wonderful work. So if you get the opportunity, please take a listen to those amazing albums. Now, we also offer bespoke training in our studios, and this includes a sound engineering certification, animation training, and film production training. And our learners then have the opportunity, once they've done this training and been exposed to it, of managing and running school productions and assemblies, or filming for the School Reporters Club, which is fondly known as Flash Mob. And this really gives our learners insights into what it's like to work in the sound and media industry, and it also allows them to add real experience to their CVs. Now, animation learners have also doing some really incredible work and building content for their portfolios. And as we all know, animation is really an incredible medium for communication. And once again, we also take them through the process of conceptualizing a brief, storyboarding, all the way through to post-production. And we normally release their content on YouTube. So here's an example of one of our learners' animations. So one of the challenges that we've had here is basically linking our animation department to real world and to the real world. And they've just begun to work with a nonprofit organization called plantastic.org.za, and they're going to create their story in a short animated form. Now, what this NPO does is it collects washed up plastic bags on beaches and then crochets them into beautiful pieces of jewelry and sells them. And then a portion of this money is donated to turtle conservation through the Two Oceans Aquarium. And obviously our team is really excited about making a positive contribution to marine life conservation. So how we encourage authentic learning at Parklands College is by giving our learners a dedicated workspace with opportunities to learn diverse skills, and in order for them to look at community challenges and to actually solve them. And then what's also really important in this whole scheme of things is to have a real audience. And the intersection of these three areas is where we find the magic happening. It's where our learners find purpose and relevance to their learning. And purpose and relevance in a school nurtures a culture of invention, creativity, and innovation. So one of our biggest questions for us has been, well, is our approach successful? And we believe that the most important place to look would be at past learners. So Luke on your left and Stefan on your right joined Parklands College in 2012 and 2014, respectively, and they both fell in love with technology at the school. And although 1 year apart, these two boys became an inseparable team as Team Infinity, and they competed in both robotics competitions and worked in application development together. So their best placing in an international robotics competition was at the World Robot Olympiad in Costa Rica, where they placed 9th in the world in an advanced robotics university category. And they also developed the app that was mentioned earlier by Paul, Simple Learning Time. So yeah, just an amazing team. Now in 2019, during Luke's matric year and Stefan's first year at university, they actually opened up their own business called Neon Solutions. And they were responsible for developing a unique Internet of Things or IoT technology solution for a mining company. And what they did was they put these devices all over the mine and collected analytic data in order to improve metal production in the mine. And the system has proven to be incredibly successful. And they're now building a profitable business while they are both studying at UCT. So both Stefan and Luke used the skills they learned in robotics coding and design at Parklands to become young, successful entrepreneurs. And this is the kind of story that we want to tell for every learner at the college. Now, McLarley, who's better known as Mitch, was very active in Parklands College Studios during his schooling career. In the Reporters Club, he developed a passion for media and presenting, and he explored all the different professional roles in the space. And he's now a celebrity and radio DJ on KFM, which is a popular local radio station. So it really has been a privilege to have had these learners in our school and to have had an influence on their lives, because they found their passions early, they've been able to focus the rest of their education on it, and they've been able to build their own futures. So we trust that this brief story of our journey has been of value to you, and we would really like to wish you and your schools every success with your journeys. And we hopefully inspire you to create many young creative entrepreneurs of tomorrow, reaching outwards, growing minds, building futures.
Thank you, Richard. It is quite something to take in. We do have some time right now for question answers. I'm going to ask that if you do have a question for us, now's a great time to put it in the live Q&A. You'll find it on the right-hand side of your screen. We're watching that as we go through, and then we can take some of your questions. From time to time, in fact, usually once a quarter, we actually have an open day, not during the time of COVID-19, but when we invite people onto our campus, because we do have such a lot of interest of what happens here in a school at the bottom of Africa in Cape Town. And one of the questions that we often come out and people have a look and they see our campus and they say, wow, I'm actually from an under-resourced school, and while I love what you're doing, where do I begin as an under-resourced school? So I'm going to throw that question to the team, and perhaps Emma, maybe I could start with you first to say, what have you done in the prep school? What are some of the simple things that you've done? I think you've shown us some of them already. So Emma, tell us, where would you start? An under-resourced school, what would you suggest?
Hi everyone. Well, Paul, dedicate a small space. It doesn't need to be a large room. It could be a shelf, it could be a table, a corner of the classroom, and allow the children that space to tinker, cut, stick, fold pieces of paper together, let blocks tumble down. Those are simple things that we all have that starts the mind thinking, and we start doing that wonderful computational thinking where we take a big problem and we break it down into its smaller parts. So find a space, any space, own it, and have fun and play.
Thank you, Emma. It's so key to start small. Start with something you do have, even if it's just a corner in a room. Richard, there's some key partnerships that you've developed along the way to make this happen. Maybe you'd give us one or two of those.
Sure, absolutely. So if you're interested in getting involved in Lego and getting Lego into your school, there is a site, I've just popped it into the chat, it's carefored.co.za, and it's basically schools can fill in an application form there and apply to receive a Lego Playbox, and I believe the Six Bricks platform will be available soon as well. So that'll certainly is an opportunity for you to bring Lego into your school. And it's great to have these partners, because then they don't only provide the equipment, they also provide the training to support you and to help you bring that into your learning space. So there's something else you could do as well. If you're looking at other platforms, there's Arduino, which is quite a cheap platform to bring into your school, or even you can get your children to bring things from home that are broken and try and fix them at school.
Thank you, Richard. We've got a question that's come through in the chat. I'm going to direct this one actually to you, Keegan, because I know you are very busy. The question says, tell us more about how learners fit all these extra activities into their day.
There's a lot of activities you can do at school. I know we have 30 and more clubs and societies. So what's nice is at school, we have a utility slot in the day. And now this slot, so if you don't do anything, you can either have a break, but in this slot you can do, if you want to do flash mob, if you want to do doodling, whatever you'd like to do, there's a club for it at our school. And they dedicate a time in the day for that. Then there's also a lot of after school activities you can take part in, whether it be robotics or if it's sport, there's dedicated time after school. The school also encourages all the learners to try to do as much as possible at home. So if, for example, in coding, they encourage us to go home, tinker and play with all that stuff and come back and share with the rest of the learners and also the staff with what we've learned, because this is a journey we're doing together every single day. We're trying to learn as much as possible. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Keegan. What a great answer to that question. So I think there are five keys we want you to take away from this presentation today. So if there were five things we wanted you to think about, this is what they are. Number one, define a vision. A well-defined vision is critical when embarking on technology integration projects such as this one. It gives people purpose and a common goal. It allows you to easily share what you want to achieve with your school community and your stakeholders. Create a unique name for your project. This allows for easy reference and relatability. Key, involve top management in the process because their commitment ensures project momentum, especially during the challenging times of staff and parent buying, buy-in, and when allocating budget. The journey is long, but it is rewarding. Key number two, support the change makers with continuous professional learning. Passionate, committed change makers, and by these we include teachers and learners, must manage the project. They are the motivators, and as well as the community and logistic liaisons. And they put in the extra time to ensure that the school gets the best experience. To excel, teachers need to develop and their related knowledge and their skills required before embarking on the project so that they are confident from the start, provide bespoke professional learning opportunities, and very importantly, dedicate time for it. This encourages creating a culture of experimentation and bravery. Key number three, create authentic, meaningful learning experiences. And you've heard so much about this today. Integrate cross-curricular project-based learning into your planning and your lessons. An engaging and fun learning process allows learners to experience a variety of integrated interests while problem-solving themselves. And the 21st century skills developed here inspire learners to share their voice and take action. Explore and participate in experimental project-based global competitions. They give learners opportunities to create solutions for real problems and make a difference in the community. And this brings purpose and meaning to their learning. Prepare for success and know the commitments and expectations involved. Key number four, dedicate a space to tinker and play. This can be a corner or it can be an entire room. It could even be an entire building where learners and teachers have the freedom to tinker and to play. And this reinforces commitment to the project and provides a constant and stable space for creativity and invention. Key here though is choose your hardware and software platforms carefully. Ensure that your choices are simple yet scalable and that you have a good support network. The success and interest in such a space will define its growth, specialization, and further investment. Let everyone play in these spaces. And then the last key, celebrate and build succession. As we've done today, applaud your learners' thinking. They have the brilliant, limitless ideas. Acknowledge and praise the teachers who provide for the landscape for accomplishment. Fail forward and fail often. Share the process, participation, success within the school, within the community, within the media, and beyond. No matter what the result, this attracts more learners and teachers to participate and ensure succession. Well, we're fast running out of time, so I want to say a big thank you for joining us today. If you would like to connect with us, please feel free to email us or to follow us at Parklands College on Facebook or on Twitter or on Instagram. Then special thanks today go to Vikas Potter, Kirsten Thompson and Brian Baptista from T4 World Education Week for organizing and managing this event. The T4 World Education Week technical team who were behind the scenes for all the training leading up to this event. The Jake School Fellowship for the invaluable support of the presenting of South African schools in this event. Ali Bray from LEGO Foundation and Brent Hutchison from Care for Education for supporting Parklands College at this event. Thanks to our own Parklands College technical team for keeping us on air, our speakers, and most importantly to you, our audience. Today, we finally leave you with a word from our sponsors. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Vikas Pota. The reason why we're organizing this global showcase for World Education Week is we believe that schools have incredible expertise in making sure that learning outcomes improve. Given the state of the world, we want to see the expertise from this particular school being replicated in schools all over our planet so that the world becomes better for everyone. That is why I congratulate this school for what it does and hope that those listening can take away conclusions as to how they should actually approach their own improvement journeys. Thank you all for participating, and I look forward to seeing you in many of the other events this coming week. And I also want to take this opportunity to thank our sponsors for supporting this incredible work, without whom we couldn't have put together this global showcase. Thank you, and I wish you well for this event.
Fast-paced, social, economic, and technology-driven change is redefining our world. And having a broad range of skills, such as creativity and problem solving, has become far more important than being able to memorize information. To redefine how our children learn and to empower them for the future, parents, teachers, and policymakers must stop overlooking a powerful part of the solution: learning through play. Play is the rocket fuel of child development, and there is a growing body of evidence to support that play is fundamental for children's positive growth and well-being over time. It is also an essential way to foster the skills required to thrive in today's world. The LEGO Foundation aims to build a future in which learning through play empowers children to become creative, engaged, lifelong learners. To do so, we work with a range of partners around the world to change the hearts and minds of all of those who influence children's lives through our programs, research, and advocacy, so they can all embrace the transformative power of play. Examples of what we do include making sure that caregivers, practitioners, and policymakers understand the importance of play, investigating, testing, and scaling new ways to bring play-based learning into homes and schools, using play to help millions of the world's most vulnerable children cope with adverse childhood experiences and toxic stress, or conducting research with some of the world's leading research institutions. Please visit our website and follow us on social media to learn more.
Language connects us all. It's how friendships are formed, ideas are shared, and lessons are learned. Language is how we find understanding and express love. It's how we communicate our successes, both big and small. It lays the groundwork for learning and growth. And for an increasingly diverse student population, it can be the key to achievement in school and beyond. That's why Rosetta Stone Education is dedicated to language and literacy. We offer solutions designed to support teachers and their emergent bilingual students, recognizing and celebrating the knowledge, culture, and languages they bring to our classrooms. Our products are founded on the adaptive blended learning model for individual needs, continuous progress monitoring for better learning outcomes, and culturally responsive pedagogies for more inclusive classrooms. With solutions aligned with proficiency standards, we support language learning while exploring academic subject areas, paving the way to better outcomes. Because for all of us, language is everything.
Dear T4 community, we talk a lot about teachers these days, but we rarely listen to them. Therefore, I am truly excited to join the T4 World Education Week to hear from teachers and school leaders all over the world how we can impact learning together. I'm particularly looking forward to the Global Showcase. 100 schools sharing their expertise and best practices, I believe, will be a huge motivation for other schools around the globe. I'm equally impressed by the T4 Solutions Challenge, its finalists and their solutions to real-world issues in education. This gives me hope that we can, together, turn around education globally. The Jacobs Foundation is a proud supporter of the T4 World Education Week because we share a vision to reimagine learning and education by bringing together the brightest people who understand how children learn. Let's do this together.